is Adam West on the set of Batman in Hollywood.
Hi, kids. This is Robin of the Batman Show. In real life, I'm Burt Ward.
Hi, this is Yvonne Craig on the Batman set. Remember your responsibility. Please be careful.
To be or not to be a careful driver, that is not the question. That is our responsibility.
Drive carefully so that no one will get hurt.
Welcome back, citizens, to an all-new episode of the Batcave podcast. It's your old bat chum, John S. Drew here, and we're getting ready for the end, folks. This is it, the penultimate review for the classic 66 series. Yes, there's going to be episodes after we're finished with the series, but it's not going to be the same because we're only going to be talking about aspects of the show. Now here, we're talking about the TV show itself, and I figure we're getting towards the end here. I had put out the call. It's kind of funny. Those last six episodes took forever to find someone to step up and say, I'll do it. And one of those people who were so gracious enough in the end, after I begged and pleaded and cried and said, you know, I'll jump off the roof, was Jim Beard. Jim Beard of Gotham City, 14 miles. Welcome, Jim.
Wait, is it gracious or is it stupid? No, I'm thrilled to be back. It seems like we just did this.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah. Thrilled to be back. Not exactly thrilled with some of these later episodes, but you know what? The thing about this show, there's always something interesting to talk about.
Exactly. Even this one, as flat as it may have left you, as you joked about on Facebook.
Well, you know what? It's like we've been saying a lot about some of these episodes is that overall you sort of may groan about it, but there's always those little nuggets in there, and sometimes those nuggets make it even harder to watch because you think, wow, that could have really been something, but they didn't have the time or they didn't have the budget.
Right. Exactly. And this was one of those episodes where we find that some of the things were because they didn't have the budget.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll get into it, but my outlook on this is that this actually could have been a multi-part episode. Maybe even one of the biggest episodes of all, with multi-parts, but it's 1.5 hour, and that's all.
The episode we're talking about is The Entrancing Dr. Cassandra. It aired on March 7th, 1968. And we get a new villain. We get a new, I guess you'd say, because they say extra special guest villain. He's not a henchman.
Yeah. No. Well, kind of. You know, I mean, he is literally just doing Dr. Cassandra's bidding. You know, so yeah, kind of interesting. But he was a big enough Howard Duff, we're talking about as
right.
Cabala, was a big enough star on his own that he, you know, got the credit that he did. But he is basically just a henchman.
He gets to do the whole, you know, why do we do this? What do we do that? And yeah, like you said, he does the heavy work for Cassandra.
Yeah, a lot of shut up and do what I say.
Right.
From her.
So we open with a teaser. Now, normally these don't bother me. I don't flinch. But for some reason, this one just, maybe it's the end. Maybe I'm getting tired. But I really had a problem with Astral Avenue branch of the Alchemical Bank and Trust Company.
Yeah, there's some bad puns or references in this. You know, we're getting really, really silly with some of them, and later on with the name of the diamond,
yes,
and the name of the jewelers that, you know, that it's at. We've talked about this before. This is, to me, one of those times where it's the concept is being either misunderstood or lost about this show, and that these are good examples of it.
And, you know, this set for the bank is probably the weirdest one ever because it can't seem to make its mind if it wants to look like a full set or if it wants to look like one of those ones with just the little bits in the background and just the black background, because they pan across the whole bank. And at first it's like, all right, black background, we're used to that. Then we get to the corner with Cassandra and Cabala, and it's a corner wall.
Right. It's a microcosm of the show. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It doesn't know what it wants to be. It's got big holes in it. Don't look over there because there's a big hole.
Yeah.
They stay right here in this tiny little corner, you know, where we have the budget.
Yeah, exactly. It's like we didn't have, we talked about that, the budget and such. Maybe it was just like, well, we could only afford a wall here and here. And since they're the stars, the guest stars, we'll give them a wall.
Yeah. And there actually was budget problems with this episode,
yes,
too. So, and it begins early.
So the two take these pills that turn them invisible. We see them invisibly knocking aside some of the patrons of the bank, and they steal a large sack of money.
That just happens to be sitting there.
Yeah, exactly. It just happens to be sitting there, and as we'll learn later on from Cabala, $600,000 just sitting there in the sack.
Right. The other thing is that you have to remember that our two villains are invisible. You have to watch the things that are going on and picture them in the shot.
Yeah.
And it falls apart. Okay, they're pushing and punching people out of the way, right?
Right.
You know what? I'm gonna step back here for a moment. There's a point of view, handheld camera point of view shot, which I'm actually going to give the director credit for on this one. When it goes up to the teller where they're going to get the money bag from, and it sounds like they punch the guy and he staggers backward, right?
Right.
But when they grab the money bag and it floats up and over, there's no way that an invisible person is doing that. Why, you know, when you know it's way across the teller window, behind the teller window. And I mean, I don't know what Cabala supposedly did. He would have had to have jumped up onto the ledge there, reached way over the teller window, grabbed that sack of money, and it goes way up into the air and then floats over the teller window and then down, you know, to a normal level. It's like, what was he doing? You know, I mean, he's really jumping and leaping and stretching and yeah.
Well, you know,
in other words, it's some wire work that they didn't really think through.
It's some wire work that they didn't really think through, and they also just didn't really think through the whole what it means to be invisible and what you can get away with when you're invisible, because the next scene is the same way. We cut to Gordon's office, and I love this. After nearly 120 episodes, O'Hara doesn't waste any time. He just heads for the phone.
Love it. I actually love that bit. And Gordon even calls it out, you know, and he says, after all our years together, you know, that you can predict, you know, what I'm thinking and what we need. And we need Batman. That's actually a nice little moment that I treasure, you know. Now, we all know it's because we have to cut to the chase.
Right.
Because this is just a half-hour episode, you know. But it's a, you know, it's a nice little touch, and it actually you know, makes a lot of sense. You know, going back to the invisible people thing, Dr. Cassandra actually points out that they're not technically invisible, that they're actually just blending in with the background.
Yes.
Okay. You know, and you know what? That's not a bad concept, to be quite honest. You know, in a science fiction / fantasy show, invisibility.
Right.
I mean, it's an old trope, but, you know, it's something interesting about it. We haven't really done that before in the show. And I dig the whole thing about her with the alchemy background. That's also very interesting. And the, well, however they say occult, but it's, everybody pronounces it weird. It's O. Calder, a cult or whatever they can say. Yeah. Adam West pronounces things really strangely, and I don't know if it's his Washington State upbringing, but he has some really weird pronunciations for certain words, like laser. He says laser as laser beam.
Yes, I remember that, yeah.
Yeah, and there's a few other things that he does like that. So, again, I like the premise of her a lot, maybe not used to, you know, its fullest.
In the office, though, we see that invisibility again being screwed up because
26 eyewitnesses who didn't see a thing. Yes, we'll get on it right away. It's good to have you with me, Chief O'Hara. After all these years, we've come to anticipate each other's thoughts.
At times like this, Commissioner, anyone can read your mind. It's Batman we need, and fast.
Very neatly put, Chief.
O'Hara's about to make the call, or Gordon. I figured it was Gordon. And the two are suddenly pinned. They start to writhe in agony. They're being held. No. One would assume it's Cassandra and Cabala, each holding one.
Yes, Commissioner.
Batfink?
Who is this speaking?
Dr. Cassandra, world-famous alchemist, occult science practitioner, and all-around evil-doing swinger.
Where's the commissioner?
Just zip your lip while I lay the word on you, Batcat. I'm gonna put Gotham City in a trance, and there's not a thing you or that junior birdman can do about it.
What's wrong?
There's a new fiend in town, Dick. To the bat pools.
But then suddenly, the two back up, the phone lifts up, and Cassandra's making the call. Now, based on the way the two of them are spread apart, they're separated from each other, one would think that Cabala must be incredibly strong to now hold the two of them back at bay in such a way that it's so painful for them while she makes the call.
Yeah, it occurred to me right when Gordon and O'Hara are reacting to being manhandled, you know, immediately I thought, okay, who has who? And, you know, because they're both being manhandled, so you have to assume that Cassandra herself is doing some grunt work here, you know? It can't just be Cabala. And I'm thinking, like, you know, I guess when she's invisible, she feels that she doesn't have to be very ladylike, because they're, you know, kind of tossing these guys around, you know. I'm assuming that Cassandra is taking care of Gordon, and O'Hara, being a burlier guy, is being taken care of by Cabala. But, yeah, you're right. It's like, I guess we're supposed to believe that they're so stunned by what's going on that Cabala doesn't really have to hold them back.
Right.
You know? That they're just so floored, you know. I don't know why, because Commissioner Gordon's office has been invaded by criminals time and time and time and time again. But I guess it's the whole, you know, invisibility thing. Again, here's a nice little moment. I love it that when somebody else uses the bat phone, and, I love it with Adam's reaction when he realizes that it's not Gordon or O'Hara, you know, calling and the who is this kind of a thing. It's very cheeky of Cassandra to issue her warning, but she's not doing her research very well, because you don't prod Batman and to get him to back off. That makes him, you know, want to look into things, you know, even more. Hey, can we talk about Cassandra and Cabala just here for a moment?
Sure.
Since they've already been introduced or whatever. This is one of the stranger relationships in this show. And it's also one of the oddest characterizations. And I'm talking about mostly their quote-unquote hip lingo. Throughout this entire episode, the way they talk. This is one of those cases where you want to sit the script writer down, you know, the screenwriter down, and ask them, like, how did you arrive upon this? You know, how did this happen, and what were you, you know, thinking? Of all the characters in this entire show, and of all the villains, why these two to try to make them hip? Is really, you know, a strange question in my mind. Do you see where I'm going with this?
I'm not entirely certain where you're going with that, because to me, to me, other than the fact that they're a little older, and I mean, to me, I found that incongruity kind of funny, especially Howard Duff, who I've seen him before in other things, and he's always comes across as a bit more, you know, very dignified, almost like a quiet version of John Wayne.
Yes, I completely agree. And I mean, I still have a little, I have some questions about that. It is supposed to be funny, I guess. You have two somewhat older people talking in this sort of stereotypical 60s slang, and it's coming off very stiff. You know, I guess that's the way it's supposed to be. You know, I don't think that they're fooling anybody. You in the beginning, you almost think like they're writing them like that so that it'll appeal to the kids. But I'm sure there's no kid at that time watching that who thought that those two were hip.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah, they probably rolled their eyes and thought, oh, these old fogies trying to, you know, talk hip. It gets really annoying with Howard Duff and his docky baby, you know, because he says it incessantly through this whole episode. You want him to just say, shut up, call her something else, just once. You know, it's like Otto Preminger's Wild. You know, it's like, shut up. Well, you said that a million times. You know, stop saying it. It's just so weird because you wonder, it's like, was that their idea to throw in those, you know, the actors throw in all that slang? Is it in the script? Was it ever meant to be, you know, like, that they're really hip? Or was it meant to be just a total joke? The acting is also pretty dang stiff in this episode throughout. You know, Howard she's not bad at all. The great Ida Lupino, you know, just with incredible credits. But he's, I don't know what it's like. It's almost like he's just not feeling this.
See, you really thought
that? You know, whole thing. Yeah.
Really? See, I was getting in. That was like one of the saving graces, I thought, was that they were kind of having some fun with it. And like I said, Duff was stepping outside his... almost like Cesar Romero, you know. I'm always floored because when you see Cesar Romero normally, he's just so subdued, and then all of a sudden it's like Joker. Wow. I mean, granted, it's not like, you know, Cesar Romero burst out, but I thought that the two of them together, and the other thing too that I noticed, and because he gets all the best lines, is, you know, the whole sexual innuendo. This episode has so much sexual
innuendo. I feel like I'm growing flat. What a shame.
What a shame. Or you know, or when she's explaining the whole idea that we blend together, that's why sometimes we bump into each other. And he's like, husbands and wives are supposed to bump into each other from time to time. I'm like, whoa.
Yeah. Yeah. To my mind, she's having more fun with it than he is.
Agreed.
We're gonna agree to disagree maybe on that one. I don't know. I thought he's kind of sleepwalking, and to be quite honest, almost everybody else is sleepwalking in this episode. Adam especially.
Mm-hmm.
You would think by now that Burt Ward would have learned to act. To me, this is almost a regression. Everybody is being so broad. Yvonne, bless her soul, she's speaking her lines in the broadest possible way in this episode.
Mm-hmm.
And then conversely, Adam is sleepwalking through it. And from his first lines onward, you can tell that he's getting bored by this point.
Yeah.
That there's very little, you know, going on for him. And Bert is just, oh, Batman, we have to do this, you know. And Yvonne is just, I don't know, she's just way out there in this one. I mean, I'm assuming that even maybe she's getting bored by this point. It's kind of tough, or at least it was for me sometime to watch this. But you mentioned about them being married, Cabala and Cassandra.
Yes.
Another really interesting bit there that they don't do much with. I'm trying to think back. Have we had a husband and wife team like that in the show?
Well, not a husband and wife team as far as the villains in terms of like that they were married, other than the closest thing being Cliff Robertson and Dina Merrill as boyfriend girlfriends, but they were married in real life.
That's a really great example. That's a good example there. So here we have a husband and wife. And again, it's kind of a shame that there's not more to it. It's interesting that, you know, she's trying to be very professional and he's overly amorous, you know, and trying to hold him off, you know. But it's just that one quick little, you know, mention, and you wish that they had been able to, you know, have more time to, you know, like, how did he end up with her, I guess. We talk about this a lot during these, you know, new villains introduced original to the show that could potentially have a lot more going on with them, and you almost wish they could have returned, you know, to flesh them out some more.
Right. Yeah, I'll get into that with my review at the end there, but one question for you, because, you know, we're getting to the end of the teaser and such. Is this the last time we're going to hear Adam utter to the Batpoles? Which, now, when you mention his lifelessness, he had no enthusiasm even saying that.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And I, you know, I noticed it, you know, immediately. It's just very subdued. I mean, more so than, you know, he undercranked it, you know, before. But this, you can really just see that it's just not clicking with him at this point.
Right. Yeah. So we get to Act One, and we see that Barbara is there as well now, and she's taking care of the two. And I'm like wondering, what's with the things on the head when it was their arms that were injured? although Gordon or O'Hara, I forget what it is, kept saying something about being clubbed away at or something like that.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe they, you know what, maybe they beat them up a little bit more, maybe, you know, before they left the office and we just didn't see it.
Right.
Or that they're just so shagged out that he has to have a cold compress on his head.
Maybe.
That also could be, you know, that's supposed to revive him or settle him down, I guess, or something like that. But yeah, you're absolutely right. Yeah, it doesn't seem to match up. At least it makes sense that Barbara's there.
Right.
You know, I can see her coming in to meet Gordon for lunch or something and finding them, you know, like that. A regular Florence Nightingale she is.
Yes. Another skill of Barbara's. She's capable with first aid.
Yes. Wait, I love that. We're getting ahead of ourselves. But is she a real doctor? No, she's not even a nurse.
Yes. And he determines, Batman, that it might have something to do with the occult,
occult. Yeah.
And he wants to consult. I thought this was interesting. Wants to go to the library, not back to the Batcave.
Yeah, no, right. Yeah, interesting. You know, I guess because that draws Barbara into it, you know, more. There's,
right.
That's another scene for Yvonne that, you know. Hey, you know, in the set for the library, in the back, on that back wall, up above, there's words that go across the top of it. I don't know why, but I've never really noticed that before. Was that always on the library set?
I don't recall it either. It's funny you point that out. I forgot to write down what the words were. Something about onwards and upwards or something like that.
That's it, yeah. Yeah, and I don't know why. It's maybe just was never shot like that, but for some reason that has never struck me. You know, strongly that there, and I, again, I'm going to give credit to the director, I assume, or the photographer for staging it this way, that they put Adam up on a platform.
Right.
And we're kind of looking down, so we're assuming he's climbing the stacks, and you know, that these occult or occult volumes are up high and stuck away, you know, kind of a thing. I like that he looked into her family. You know, we just heard the explanation of her family, and then he discovers it, too. Another little nice bit.
Just as I suspected.
What is it, Batman?
This medi-quack, Dr. Cassandra, is none other than Cassandra Spellcraft, offspring of the infamous Spellcraft clan, a group of ne'er-do-well alchemists who couldn't even make the grade in girls' pharmacy school.
Holy unrefillable prescriptions.
Is she really a doctor?
She isn't even a nurse.
What's that?
The portable bat phone.
Yes, Commissioner. We'll be right there.
A new development?
Dr. Cassandra has challenged us, Robin. She's called the Commissioner and announced that she will steal the mope diamond from Spiffany's jewelry salon at precisely 2 o'clock. That gives us 20 minutes to thwart her. Let's go, Robin.
You know, I like that she's sort of a legacy character. You know, that she had her, as she says, foremothers, you know,
yes.
Before yeah. her. That, you know, another little interesting, you know, bit there. There's not much in the way of, well, this is, alchemy is not technically magical. They kind of are crossing two things here. I mean, alchemy and the occult, you know, not necessarily, you know, lining up.
No, but
you
know, a lot of people make that confusion when it comes to alchemy and such. They look
yeah,
at it as...
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, we don't get a lot of, you know, quote-unquote magical things going, you know, on in this show. We have Marcia Queen of Diamonds and Aunt Hilda, of course, is, you know, some kind of a witch or something, you know, like that and likes her chemicals, too. So, again, I like that bit. I like that scene in the library, and especially like the way it's staged.
I like the scene in the library, and I like just before you were saying about how she talks about her four mothers and such, and I like the little nod to Londinium.
Oh, wonderful, yeah. I one of those rare references to another episode. Perfect, love it.
And it makes me wonder, in making that nod, had we gone to a fourth season, if Batman would have returned to Londinium?
Yeah, yes.
You know?
I have a lot of thoughts about a fourth season. a lot of thoughts, and I hope we get to talk about it somewhere down the road.
I think we can definitely do a back computer episode on the potential for a fourth season and what it could have entailed.
Great.
Yeah.
Great.
And I like this. At the library, we also get to see the portable bat phone as Gordon calls Batman to warn him about the planned theft. And this is where we get your little play on words there, the mope diamond at Spiffany's.
Oh, the mobile bat phone. Oh, you liked it. I can tell. So I liked maybe it. I shouldn't say anything.
I just thought it was hysterical. He pulls out that little phone.
Okay.
And it's not even like, from what I could tell, it's one of those oval phones that usually
right,
I don't mean to. This is going to sound sexist, but usually, I every time I've ever seen those oval shaped phones in television or movies, it was usually by the bedside of a woman. A single woman.
Sure.
So it's like he's carrying around. But it makes sense, though, because it would fit better. It doesn't look as clunky as if he pulled out the regular rotary phone that we're used to.
This is stepping over a... That was stepping over a line.
Okay.
For me.
Okay.
For me. That's too silly. Too silly by far for me that it's a miniature phone. I don't mind the idea of a mobile bat phone. That, again, Batman's way ahead of his time, you know.
Right.
That's pulling out a cell phone right there, you know. But that it's literally a miniature phone, you know, with a little cord and a handset. And oh, no.
And he holds the little handset up to it. It's just...
Oh, no, 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 no. And the funny thing is that he does his typical, when he puts it away, he takes it out and puts it away, it's always back behind, you know, him where we don't see it. But I really watched. There doesn't seem to be anybody there, because usually these bigger things that he takes out of his utility belt and then puts back, there's a prop person out of the shot
right.
that he's handing these things to, because it's obviously too big to go into the... But it doesn't look like there's very much room in the way they have the shot, that I think that he actually did stick that back onto his belt somehow. It doesn't look like he hands that off to somebody.
Oh, you know, the whole scene at Spiffany's, I liked it for one thing and one thing only.
Okay.
The clerk.
Welcome to Spiffany's, folks. I'm G. David Shine. May I serve you today?
Oh, just browsing, Dad.
One does not browse at Spiffany's, madam. One either buys or one leaves.
Okay.
Now, I didn't know this till I went and did the research that this was G. David Shine, assistant to
Joseph
McCarthy.
That's really the guy's name.
Yeah.
He's an odd person. Obviously not an actor. Although there's one or two moments where he sort of does break through this inability to act, and there's some emoting, you know, there. But if I think I know where you're going, I think that adds to it, his complete and almost complete lack of acting ability. It adds some kind of weird twist
to the whole thing. Yeah, but it's also just, of all people, I mean, you know, and we're so used to window cameos and we've done floor cameos and such. And it's like, of all people, you get the assistant to Joseph McCarthy.
Do you think anybody, like, even then knew who he was when, as soon as he shows up and he says his name? I mean, I don't know, you know, like, did people go, oh my God, that's G. David Shine. Like, who?
I mean, McCarthy was, you know, the whole trials and everything was. It was pretty, one would assume there's on the to the Batpoles blog, not related to the Batpoles podcast. They're two different things. But on the blog, they show the cover of a Time magazine with McCarthy and Shine on it. I mean, compared to, say, the Carpet King, who I'm like, everybody's scratching going, who's this guy?
or Susie Knickerbocker.
Right.
Carpet King. Oh, my God. Well, you got to wonder, who knew G. David Shine and got him into this episode?
Right.
And why?
And why?
But it's the beauty of this show, with these weird things that just come out of nowhere,
right,
you know, and sort of add to the overall craziness of. And you know what? This is not a bad set either.
No, it's not.
It's a full set, and it actually looks like it has a lot of stuff in it.
Mm-hmm.
It, you know what I mean? It's like, I don't. It's not like there's one podium, one, you know, display stand with two diamonds sitting on it. You know, it actually gives you the impression that it's a real jewelry store.
Yes. Yeah. No. I thought that set actually worked.
I love the part where she says, you know, or I'm going to use this gun on you and flatten you. And you know, would you like that gift wrap? Oh, wait, hey, we haven't even talked about the Alvino ray.
That's right. You know, the trio arrive and Cassandra uses the Alvino ray, and that's where we get that line where Cabala says,
what are you doing to our bodies?
Docky, baby, you are super psychedelic.
Holy helplessness.
I feel like I'm getting flat.
What a pity.
What a pity is Batgirl's getting flat. Yeah.
I feel like I'm being flat.
Oh my God!
So Alvino Ray, like, did you look this one up?
I did look this one up. Yep. But you go ahead.
Yeah. Just another one of these weird things. He's some kind of American swing musician,
right?
You know, like I, you know, again, I feel like I read somewhere. It's not in the official Batman Bat book about this, but I feel like I read somewhere about Stanley Ralph Ross, the, you know, who wrote this, and why he named it after this guy. I guess in a way it almost sounds like it could be some real thing. She's an alchemist, and Alvino, you know, maybe sounds like something like that. But yeah, this guy, that was his stage name, Alvino Ray, and that was R-E-Y. And for somehow he ended up in Batman as a villain's weapon.
Well, you know what the original weapon was supposed to be called?
No, see, maybe I'm forgetting something.
Okay.
Here. Go ahead.
Yeah, because this, I believe this was in the Bat book. I know it was in the Cinefantastique piece on the series and such. It was supposed to be called the Ronald Reagan.
Oh, yes, I have read this. You know what? Maybe it's in another part in the Bat book that's not at the episode pages or that it talks about that. Yes, you're right. And did they, at that time, they thought that was just too much?
The networks nixed it.
Yeah, yeah, right. Because Reagan would have been governor of California at that
Correct.
Time. Yeah, okay, right. So it became the Alvino Reagan, the Ronald Reagan. Oh, man.
Now, here's my question to you. The three are flattened, And as we'll see,
yeah,
they get to headquarters and the forms are slipped under the door. I liked that.
Yeah.
But I got to wonder, where did the props go?
Yeah,
Who has those props?
I rewatched this before, you know, we sat down to record this, and I really was looking at those props, and I kept going back and forth. At first, I thought that those were existing publicity photos of the three of them, and that they had to make sure the actors lined up their poses to go so that they could become those publicity shots. But then I went back on that because I wasn't so sure. There's a really wonderful thing when they're brought into Gordon's office. No, maybe it's a little later with Alfred. You know what it is? It's when Alfred picks them up from the post office. You can see that they had the Batgirl one has a back to it. And it's a shot of her from the back.
Hmm.
And it's like, that's really interesting because they didn't have to go that far. They could have had the actors manipulate those cutouts to the point where you don't have to see the backs of them. But they actually went to the trouble. And it makes me wonder if the Batman and Robin one have photos on the back of them that again, were, you know, photos of the backs of them on there. So then it made me think that no, maybe those weren't, you know, publicity photos at the time, that was all done up for the show. It's interesting that at that time that the printing technology was that good to get such, you know, really good clear photos of them that big.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, but it's fun, you know, they kept the heights, you know, looks like the heights were pretty, you know, correct on it. But yeah, you got to wonder, like, did somebody take those? Did they get destroyed? They're pretty thick. I don't know if they're wood or what. Today they probably would have used foam board,
mm-hmm.
but they're at least an inch thick. So again, you know, they're kind of hefting them around pretty easily. So I don't know what other, if that was maybe that was styrofoam.
Maybe.
You know, at that time, or what? But they look like they're pretty light.
I just remembered there was a Bionic Woman episode where they had a cardboard figure of Oscar Goldman, and they were practicing shooting darts at it, the bad guys and such. And that actually wound up in auction about a year ago. And my friend Jim Sherrard got it, and he told me the pin marks are still there from where the dots were shot at it and such. So to me, I'm like wondering, who's got Batman, Robin, and Batgirl Alvino Raid?
Really?
It's got to be out there somewhere.
There's so many props, you know, like this from the show that you know, you could assume probably got destroyed.
Yeah.
You know, I think of all the different paintings on the walls. You know, the stuff that was in Gordon's office. Now, that may have gone back in. That was probably taken from the, you know, the prop room of the studio and put back in, you know. But, like, the painting of the safe that hangs over Adam West's safe, or Bruce Wayne's safe. It's a painting of a safe.
Right.
You know, like, what happened to that, you know? And so on and so on with some of these things. But yeah, really, really, you know, really great one. Are those still out there somewhere?
And you know what also was a really freaky bit? Because we're getting to the end of Act One now where the...
I can't believe me eyes, Commissioner. But I must believe what I feel.
Yeah.
And I feel their pulse.
The pulse.
The pulse,
yep.
Yeah, the pulse.
Yeah. Yeah, another really interesting moment. And then I love it because immediately Gordon leans down and tries to listen for, you know, Batman's, you know, heartbeat or whatever. Creepy and weird, you know. I mean, I don't know, did those things feel warm? And it gets creepier when we come back and Gordon says that really horrific thing about that they're going to have to spend the rest of their lives like that. And it is, he says, like, unspeaking, unmoving or whatever. So then you have to kind of wonder, like, okay, they can they see? Can they hear?
Well, that was my question.
Yeah. I doubt it because Batgirl would have seen Alfred,
right,
seen how he got it, got them into the Batcave, so on and so on. Maybe Gordon actually says unseeing, but there would have been no way for him to have known.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, that too. But yeah, probably there's not enough room there for the rays, you know, in the eyeballs for that to work. So that, you know. Or maybe it's just a fantasy episode. I don't know. On a fantasy TV show.
Right.
But it is creepy. Like I have a little bit of claustrophobia and a little bit of fear of the water, kind of a thing of, you know, being cut off, you know, breathing cut off and that sort of thing. So that is a creepy moment when Gordon, you know, offers that cheerful, you know, little saying there about how they'll be stuck like that forever.
Yeah. I thought it was funny, though, because O'Hara then suggests that they call the bat phone and talk to the voice. And Alfred, yep, you know, arranges to have them picked up at the main office, the main branch of the post office. And I thought, like, you know, this was Gordon's opportunity to have them followed if he ever felt like, you know, he wanted to learn more.
Yeah. This whole sequence is both interesting and very troubling.
Okay, how is it troubling?
Troubling because it's this part of the show that you suspend your disbelief through so much of this show. You have to.
Yes.
But the thing about Alfred answering the bat phone is one that stretches it almost to the point of breaking, and this is another great example. Now, I really love it that they call this out. The voice. I love it that he says the voice. The voice? Yeah, the voice on the phone that sometimes answers the bat phone. And I love it that they have it, like, it's almost like that's the name that they have for it. You know, it's probably capital T and capital V, the voice. You know, I love that, almost love that concept. But again, it's there's too much risk going on there with Alfred answering the phone. Obviously, he has a British accent. He has a very, you know, obviously O'Hara and Gordon both know Bruce Wayne's butler, Alfred. You know, it's bad enough that they don't recognize Bruce Wayne and Dick Grayson's voices when they're talking to Batman and Robin. You know, but okay, you say, okay, that's part of the show, you know, but when you get to Alfred, and as many times that they've talked to him, and in some episodes it's not just a I'll get him, you know, it's an on and on and on, I'm very sorry, you know, Batman's on vacation and he's not here right now, and you know, it's like, stop talking. They're going to recognize your voice. So here's one of these weird things. It's an interesting thing. I love it that it's acknowledged that there's a person that answers the phone that is not Batman and Robin.
Right.
But it just goes far too much into this realm of risking their identities, you know, like that. And then the guy at the post office. Does Gordon later go, hey, did those cutouts get picked up? And the guy goes, yeah. And Gordon says, well, who was the guy that picked them up? And Gordon, or does the guy describe Alfred, you know? Obviously, he's got a little beard on, kind of a goatee thing or whatever, but it's like, yeah, he was a tall British guy, you know, with glasses and real just kind of distinguished looking, you know, real tall and skinny or whatever. It sounds like Alfred, the Wayne Butler. No, this guy had a goatee. Oh, okay. Well, that couldn't have been him.
Couldn't have been him.
Yeah. General, or what is it? He said, send them to general delivery or whatever that was. You know, that's one of those things that you don't really do at the post office anymore, where
right,
you just put somebody's name on something and send it to the post office and it gets to where it's going. But yeah, he picks them up at the... Huh.
And the goatee Alfred is wearing is darker than his own white hair.
Yes. Yes, yes it is. Oh, he's wearing a hat, so you know. I want to know how he gets them into the Batcave. Like, you know, like what entrance does he use? Does he take them through Wayne Manor? Is he sneaking around making sure Aunt Harriet doesn't see those? Alfred? What are you doing with those?
Oh, they're for a children's party that Master Wayne is going to be throwing. Yeah.
Oh, good.
He can't take. I mean, do they fit into the Alfred elevator, or does he take them into the, you know, Blue Grotto entrance or whatever that's called? I'm sorry, you know, I have to know these things.
As you would say sometimes to me, Jim, therein lies madness.
I know. Yep. Yep. Don't go down that path.
So,
so,
you know, Alfred's got them picked up. But in the meantime, we go to the penitentiary and we see the alarms are going off and no one can see who's sneaking in because, of course, the two are invisible. But they revealed themselves and they...
Yeah.
You know, there's this whole, it's this whole big thing with, like, you know, she uses the intercom to tell the villains she's going to free them. There's a countdown. And, you know, it's interesting. Even with the Blu-rays, the wide shot, you still can't tell. You look at them and you go, hey, maybe that is Cesar Romero. Of course, obviously, when they get up close, yeah, you can tell. And you know for sure that's not Julie Newmar, which is also odd that they switched to Julie Newmar for the end of the third season when they've been going with Eartha Kitt. But that Julie Newmar looked a little pudgier in the face.
Yeah, I really tried to look this time, you know, at them. And to be quite honest, the Joker's not that bad.
No.
You can kind of see him. You can pass that off as Cesar Romero.
Mm-hmm.
The King Tut is pretty bad.
Yeah.
You see him very clearly when they're walking out. The Riddler, not so bad, and he's got the mask to help it. You don't really get the Penguin very clearly. He looks shorter than Burgess Meredith. Egghead, you know, you mostly see him from the back. You see a little bit more of his face when they're later on in Cabala's, or in Cassandra's lair, and there you see the side of his face more, and it doesn't look, you know, like him. But this is where... There's way more going on here. It doesn't deserve a half-hour episode.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And the thing with Egghead, too, I noticed it, too, is that you're right. He could almost pass except for one other thing. One of the things I was always impressed with Egghead was, because a lot of times when you put the bald cap on, is that you could see the seams. I always thought, even with the Blu-rays, that they did a good job with the makeup on Vincent Price, making him look like he was bald.
Yeah.
The skull cap that they use on this guy is bulging in the back.
Yes, it is. Yeah, I did notice that. At least he's, you know, tall.
Yes.
You know, like Vincent Price. The other ones, that their heights seem okay. Again, it's just that I thought that the Penguin seemed a little short. But the whoever was the Riddler, that, you know, that's Frank Gorshin's proportions, you know, that you know, looked enough like him. Do you feel like it's a kind of an odd assortment? Like, King Tut doesn't need to be in there because King Tut shouldn't be in prison.
Right.
He's, you know,
having therapy.
I realize that they use King Tut a lot, you know, late, especially in third season. But we all know that he's not responsible for his actions. Why is he in prison?
Right.
You know, I can only guess that at this point he doesn't change back to the professor, and he's so stuck in the King Tut, you know, persona that they throw him in prison. I guess I don't know. You know, I mean, it's the main villains, but it's the King Tut one that kind of bugs me. I don't know who else they could have thrown in there, but
well, it's a nice little nod to, I mean, you've got the core four, and then a couple of their created ones who got multiple. The only other ones that, like, you know, possibly would have fit in there would have been like Louis the Lilac, or
yeah.
Actually, I was kind of surprised they didn't throw in Mr. Freeze.
Yeah, see, there, that would have been a good one, because yeah, you know, the outfit would have been very striking to see, and yeah, that's an interesting one.
Yeah, in the Batcave, Alfred uses, it's either the freezing chamber from the Mr. Freeze episodes, or the X-ray bombardment chamber from the, where was it, from the Mad Hatter episode to restore, yeah, the trio.
Or all of the above.
Right.
Yeah. Here's another, you know,
shorthanding. I mean, a lot of bat gadgets are shorthanders, but this is, we're really getting shorthanded, you know, now. The three-dimensional bat restorer.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, okay. But it does the trick.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, well, it does the trick. But you know what, though? That's the thing. There's shorthand, and then there's just cheats. And to me, this is a cheat. There's something else later on that we'll get into that I also found is a bit of a cheat as well. That it's like, really, you couldn't have done a little bit more with it. I did like the whole idea of, you know, and certain things that could have been left hanging. Alfred recalls the Batmobile, you know, has it come back to the Batcave. Mm-hmm. And we've already seen it can drive on its own anyway in the past. We saw it with the Penguin three-parter.
I love that whole thing, you know, that recalling it. And it doesn't, it takes a little while to get there.
Yes.
You know, because it's got to drive 14 miles.
Oh, here you go. This was it. This was where I had the problem with the shortcut. Because now once the three are restored, they get the call about the villains on the loose. Oh, my God, this sounds... This is kind of like the episode where the Joker's flying saucer, where they put the bomb in the Batmobile and you know, the thing blew up. And you'd think, okay, this should be so much more as Batman and Robin are trying to dig their way out. But no, it's like, boom, we just shortcut. Same thing. It's like, oh, my gosh, the villains are loose. This should be momentous. Yeah. And it's like, no, because we've only got about 8 minutes left. So we got to wrap this up. Not only do we have to wrap this up, we're not even going to bother with detective work. I'm going to use the escaped villain locator on the back computer.
Yeah, special escaped arch criminal bat locator in the back computer.
You know?
Yeah. But real quick about this villain thing. This is where, if they were able to do this, imagine the, you know, what could have been done. A multi-part episode.
Sure.
Where they have to track down each one of these villains. This is another thing where this show is ahead of its time, because you get into the comic books 80s, 90s, and then into the new millennium, that's become a trope. Arkham Asylum, somebody blows it up or whatever, or Blackgate Prison, and releases all the bat villains.
Yeah.
And then you get a multi-part storyline where, you know, Batman has to go and put them all, you know, back in because they're swarming over the city and all of that. You know, imagine that literally they could have gone, okay, next episode we're going after the Joker, and it's Cesar Romero. Then we have to go after the Riddler, and it's Frank Gorshin, and on and on and on. This is immense. This is huge. And you, like you said, we only have 7 or 8 more minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah. What an incredible, you know, story concept, and I give them credit for coming up with it. And it's fun that it's not really those actors, you know, but in a way these are official appearances of these villains, of these characters. But, yeah, just way too big of a thing to handle in just a couple of minutes.
Right.
And don't tell me that each one of those villains is going to go along with this.
Well, not going to go along with it after a while. I mean, remember, there was that Ma Parker episode where Catwoman was, you know, following Ma Parker at least briefly in that cameo scene. And as we learned, those that stirred trouble, like Penguin and Joker, cooled their heels in the pen. So, you know, sure, I think at first they're going to see what's the deal before striking out on their own.
Okay, but you know what? We needed that scene.
Oh, sure.
These are the most egotistical villains ever. There's no way that the Penguin doesn't look at them and say, "Who are you? Okay, you got us out of prison, but you're not even from Gotham City or whatever. Well, I don't even know who you are, and you expect me, the Penguin, to follow you? Egghead, the supposedly the smartest villain on the planet, and he's going to follow these guys? The Joker. The Riddler, wait, well, let's forget about all the rest of them. The Riddler is going to follow them, the Prince of Puzzlers, you know, the genius of crime, and he's going to follow these two people, you know, these, like, aging hippies or whatever they are, you know. King Tut is going to follow these people, you know. Catwoman, maybe. sorry,
Catwoman and Sandman, she was going to double cross him too. No, she wouldn't have done it. What I also thought was just really annoying was that Cassandra basically thought like she could just play on their foibles. It's like,
all right, darlings, here's how we divvy up the territory. Catwoman gets all the fish market areas. Egghead, poultry farms. Penguin, ponds and parks. King Tut, museums. Riddler and Joker, all the amusement parks.
Don't forget to tell them how we cut up the loot, doggy baby.
Oh, yes. Well, darlings, we get 50% of everything you steal. But in return, I provide camouflage pills and protection.
Arguably the two biggest villains of all, right? In this show. But, and not only do they get lumped together, but they get the amusement parks. I would, excuse me, how many amusement parks does this city have?
Exactly.
Parks. It's like, okay, I know it's supposed to be like New York City. Okay, folks, let's stop. How many amusement parks does New York City have? As far as I know, none.
None.
Yeah. So, again, it's like, I know Gotham City has everything, but if I was the Joker, I would have raised my hand and said, there's only one amusement park, and it's abandoned. Remember? You know? So, no, I don't think so. I think we want half of the city, you know, just half of it. Yeah, there's no way that Joker and Riddler are going to sit still for that, you know. But no, they just sort of sit there and cackle.
Right, with the sound bites, you know, of the cackling.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I would have looked down the right line and said, Catwoman gets the fish markets? That's at least something, you know. Wait, King Tut gets the museums? There's probably, granted, a lot of museums in Gotham City, right?
Right.
You know, there's however many museums, and, you know, those two got shafted bad, and yet they go along with it, you know. I don't, the Joker's insane, so maybe he's, I don't know what's going on in his mind. No way, Riddler. Riddler says, I'm out.
Yeah.
you're on your own. Goodbye. Thanks for getting me out, but I'm gone.
Oh. And I got to ask you this. How many thrusts of manhood does Robin have? Because I know he's used that line before.
I was hoping that you weren't going to go there. I was hoping we were just going to skip right over that and move along. But no, I'm sorry. He's already had a few, you know. It's like, well, it's suddenly like Batman thinks it, like he's suddenly interested in girls, like at the end of third season, you know. No, remember in the first episode when you chastised him for supposedly being thinking about that cute little teenager that waved at him, you know, the very first episode, Batman.
But even that line, the thrust of manhood, I think he's used that with Robin before. And again, I think he just put it in there because, again, we've been doing all these sexual jokes throughout the episode.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, they sensed that they were at the end, you know, and it really kind of figures into that do whatever you want to do with the show.
Yeah.
You know. And that's, you know, I don't think he ever uses that word before, but there's one time where he says, when you get a little older, you'll realize that a little bit more about, it was something about women or whatever, you know, he says that kind of thing, but this is pretty strong stuff for this show. And at this time, I'm almost surprised the censors let that one pass.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Adam actually sort of gives that one a little extra, you know, oomph. He's kind of sleepwalking through the rest of this, you know, but I think maybe that tickled his fancy, that one, you know. Jeez.
So we get to the hideout where the trio surprise the gang.
Don't get knocked unconscious or you'll all materialize again.
You foolish, foolish woman.
Quick, swallow the pills.
They're gone.
Well, how can we fight them if we can't see them?
We may not be able to see them, but I have the feeling they're still here.
I liked this bat fight until I learned how it came about. Then I was sorely disappointed. Because, honestly, you look at it, it's different. And at first, mm-hmm. Batgirl's even actually getting hit. Because we've never seen Batgirl get hit. She may get tossed around. She may get grabbed. But nobody ever takes a punch or a kick to her. She is physically attacked by someone. One would presume either Dr. Cassandra or Catwoman in the episode.
One
we don't know because because it's invisible.
But
we see them at least get into something there. And I thought, oh, and that's clever. Let's even the odds. We'll cut out the lights. And then I learn, oh, no, this was all a budgetary consideration because we couldn't afford to block out the fight. And I'm like, I mean, granted, you know, way to go, Stanley Ralph Ross, for thinking on your feet.
We're outnumbered 8-3.
It's not the odds, Robin, it's the atmosphere.
Wait a minute. They'd be in the same boat if they couldn't see us.
You're right.
But I thought this was just something he'd cleverly put in from the beginning.
No, and you know what? You can see that they probably thought they were being really clever. You know, like, what are we going to do here? We'll just film it in the dark. You know? And, you know, wow, that's different, you know? And it's like, no. You're right. When it first begins and they're, you know, our three heroes are being tossed around, you know, the way they are, there's something kind of interesting there.
Groovy party, baby. Groovy.
Something must have gone wrong.
Alchemy is a highly specialized chemical science, Dr. Cassandra. Sometimes even experts go wrong.
And obviously something went wrong with your last batch of camouflage pills.
Oh, you goof, Ducky baby. The family curse again.
Well, nothing's gone wrong with my flattening Alvino ray gun.
It won't work, Dr. Cassandra. I took the precaution of inserting an anti-Alvino ray bat disintegrator in my utility belt. Batgirl, telephone Commissioner Gordon and his men in blue. Tell them to come over here.
Robin, round up the rest of these artless arch criminals.
Although I get a bit of kick out of the chairs that fly in from offset.
Yes.
You know what I mean? They're just being tossed by these, you know, stagehands, you know, from you know. It's like if they could have had the money to just do one wire bit.
Right.
You know, one little wire trick with, like, something on a wire that made it look like the chair picked up off the ground, swung through the air, and hit one of them. You know, but no, we know that they didn't have that money at all.
Now, a couple of things about the very, not the very ending, but the ending of this fight when they're done. Did you notice that Batman has his flashlight upside down?
No, I didn't notice
that. Because he's got a bat logo on the lens of the light itself, and it's upside down. He's holding it wrong.
No.
Or they put the logo on wrong, one way or the other. I don't know. Because I forget how he...
Or Adam West was just past caring.
And we talked about the portable phone. If Batman has a portable phone, why does he give Batgirl a dime to go call the police?
I don't know.
I was fascinated with the phone, because later on it doesn't show up.
Yeah. There is another interesting shot there, and I'm going to give the director credit as much as I can here. I love the shot where he clicks on the flashlight and he starts moving it slowly across the unconscious villain.
Yes.
I really love that. There's something almost noirish about that shot.
Yep. Now, normally I don't talk about the epilogue, but this epilogue was really interesting, and I wanted to touch on a few points. Because first of all, we wrap up the Cassandra case with O'Hara and Gordon talking as they're entering Minerva's health spa. I like the whole idea that the warden has put them in cells with polka dots so they can't blend in.
Yeah. I mean, as if all the other things that they were up against, you know, standing in front of before. Yes, but it at least was a funny little clever, you know, thing. What was it like? Is it any wonder that the prison matron's name is Mrs. Frisk?
Yes.
Mrs. Frisk.
And then there's the whole thing when they step up to Minerva and start talking to her. And again, with the sexual innuendo when she goes, I feel like a new man.
Yeah. That's just downright weird. Like, what? Can you run that one by me again? If I was Gordon, I would have said, that doesn't really work.
Yeah.
Like, that joke doesn't really work, does it?
No. No, but I had to wonder, because she had her share of husbands in her time. I had to wonder if maybe that was like she'd just gotten over a divorce or something, and so they worked in that joke for her sake.
Could be. Yeah, I'm sure that could be.
You know, I love the set. It's actually a real, I mean, there's a hallway, it goes down, you see doors. Yep. I mean, it's probably all black in the background behind it, but it's an actual set.
It's an actual set, yep. Yeah, right at the end.
Right at the end.
Who would have sunk it?
And speaking of the end, what's with the oddly placed the end as she walks off with O'Hara and Gordon?
I don't know.
You know, like I said, normally I don't do, because they just serve a purpose of introducing you to the next villain. But there was just so much going on in that little scene. I felt like we got to talk about this because it's so weird.
Yeah. I don't know. This is the end. Literally, you know, and
they knew by the broadcast time that the show was over.
Yeah.
Maybe they were giving like their own little nod. Get ready.
It could be. Yeah, it could be. You know, or I don't. You know, I keep going back to this, like, nobody caring anymore. You know, it's whatever. Do whatever you want. It doesn't really matter. It's over anyways.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
Could be. You know, a little of that.
So Cassandra and Cabala, I think we pretty much have covered what we liked and disliked about the two of them. Was there anything you wanted to add?
No, just that it is a coup for that show to have gotten Ida Lupino. I hate to say it, but I think she's kind of forgotten. When you talk about the show and the people involved, you know, she doesn't come up. But she is an incredible person. Her career was, you know, just amazing, because other than being an actress, she was a director. It looked like, I was looking up her credits on IMDb, and it looked like she didn't do any directing after 1968. She did a lot of films in the 50s, and they're, you know, well regarded. And then it looked like she was started doing a lot of TV. But it looks like at 1968 that she was pretty much done. She went on in acting. She kept acting, you know, into the 70s, but as far as directing, I think that pretty much ended in 1968. And she directed an episode of Ghost and Mrs. Mirror in 1968.
Wow.
Yeah. She directed 4 episodes of Gilligan's Island.
Oh,
isn't
gosh.
That funny? Yeah.
That's weird.
Yeah, and then Howard Duff again. And we talked about this before. I'm a devotee of radio classics on Sirius Satellite Radio, and Howard Duff shows up a lot. He had a couple different shows that he starred in. One was Richard Diamond, the private investigator.
Right.
It's interesting I never really knew who he was before, and then to find out of his, you know, incredible career, too. I'm pretty sure that's a toupee that he's wearing as Cabala. I think it's got to be, you know. And of course, in real life, they were married. If I remember correctly, Howard was Ida Lupino's third husband. I think they stayed married for a while. They had a daughter together. So, you know, again, another one of these, well, two people that had long, long careers long before Batman. And to, you know, to end up on the show again was, you know, a real coup for them. And I really like Ida Lupino here. I'll say it again. I'm not too thrilled with Howard Duff in this, but I really like her. She seemed to understand the show, and she seemed to, you know, enjoy the lines. And you know, and it's an interesting character.
Yeah. No, I would agree. Like I said, I got a little more out of it than you did. I just found the two of them together. Were they having the most fun? No. And considering how hip and mod, they could have even been more crazier. You know, I it's funny because a few weeks ago we did Louis the Lilac. And one of the things I had to admit was that I actually liked Louis because Burl really didn't stomp all over the place like he could have. And he actually played him somewhat menacingly and such. And it was a pretty good performance. Here, I think actually they could have probably taken it even more of a notch up. Who knows? Maybe they were responding to West and them. It was like West is. They probably walked in maybe and were like, hey, we're on Batman. This is exciting. And Batman, you know, and West is like, hi. You know, like at that point, maybe maybe the energy in the room was just so dead anyway. Because it's strange because you've got Sam Strangis, who's directed episodes before. You've got the story by Stanley Ralph Ross. You've got Ida Lupino and Howard Duff. You would think all that combined would bring out something stronger, but it doesn't. I'll give you that. You're absolutely – I still like them, though. To me personally, I did like them.
Yeah. You know, if you follow Adam West, you know, autobiography, he talks a lot about when they got down to this point about all the ideas that he had. There may have been a little bit of sour grapes too going on. That supposedly he was suggesting new villains and other things that could be done, and obviously none of it was being done. You know, so he by this point is just sort of given up the ghost, I guess, you know, of the whole process. And although I can't imagine that he wasn't impressed by Ida Lupino coming in, and Howard Duff too, you know, for that matter, none of that shows in this episode. I get the impression he's, I hate to say this, sometimes in this, Adam almost seems to be rolling his eyes at what's going on. You know, he's either bored or just like, kind of a thing. I don't know.
Yeah. I can understand. He said it many times that how he lost interest towards the end there and such, but.
Yeah.
All right.
The real question here is why Batgirl does not say something about Dr. Cassandra wearing one of Barbara Gordon's outfits. No, it's not Barbara Gordon's outfits. As soon as I said that, it came out of my mouth. This outfit that she wears is worn by a Mall, right? It almost looks like something Barbara would wear, but it's actually an outfit worn by a Mall in an earlier episode.
Was it one of Louis' Malls?
No. I can see her in my mind's eye. She's dark-haired. She had kind of a bob haircut. I'm going to have to hand
Clock
in my
King.
My Batman membership card.
Clock King.
Yes.
It was Clock King's
I believe
mom.
That's it. Is it? Yeah.
Oh.
But yeah, that's this outfit. I apologize for the whole Barbara Gordon thing because it looks like it's even the colors like they like to put on you know Yvonne for the show. It almost seems like a Barbara Gordon outfit, but that would have been too much, I guess, to have it in the same season. Yeah, but yeah, it's that.
No, you want to know something? Because I did a quick look. It's the same style, but it's not the same outfit.
Is it not?
No. Unless, Jim, this is that same dress from the internet meme because the Mall had a blue one.
No, yeah, this is, I swear somebody else has this. You know what it is? Is it the girl in Joker's Last Laugh, Joker's Epitaph? Is it Josie Miller? Doesn't Josie Miller wear this outfit? Sorry.
Now you got me like, you know.
Okay. Well, you're going to have to research that. I need to know. I swear that this outfit has been worn before.
It is the same. It is the same. It's got
Thank
more.
You.
She's got a little bit more of a plunging neckline on hers. She shows a little more off than Ida Lupino does.
On Josie Miller, you
yes.
mean?
Yes.
Yeah.
But it's the same outfit.
Yep.
Wow.
Yep.
Look at that. I'm like flipping back and forth between the two. All right, well, we'll definitely put pictures of that up on the Batcave podcast when we're releasing this episode. This will be fun.
Good.
Oh, good catch there, sir.
Thank you. I don't do much, but... Well, you know how fascinated I am by the malls.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are, as attested by your mall wars. Oh no. Oh no. Okay, get this. It wasn't because I'm scrolling down the page of, you know, with it wasn't just the Joker's mall. It was also Minstrel's mall wore the same outfit.
Okay, and you know what? That's probably what I'm thinking of too. Yeah. Oh, that budget.
Oh my God.
Yep, it's a cruel mistress.
Wow. Three different women wearing the same outfit.
Yep.
Wow, that's funny.
Yeah, I'm hoping Ida Lupino didn't know that.
Yeah, I know,
it's
right?
It's kind of insulting to her. The great Ida Lupino comes in, and we're not going to make her an original outfit. Just reuse one of those ones as we got.
That's
all right.
It.
Can she wear a hat? Yeah, give her a hat. Can we buy it? No.
No.
Get a hat from someone. Give her the puzzler's hat.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm kidding. I'm joking.
Oh. God, that's funny. All right, let me ask you this, back at you.
Okay.
What was your favorite?
Yeah. Oh, none of them. Phew. I'll go with the most ridiculous one of them all, the anti-Alvino Ray Bat Disintegrator.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, just not only because of the name, but just because it's another example of we need to do something quick here, and there's, you know, we don't need to think it through. Just have something that he takes out that takes care, that exactly takes care of that exact thing.
You know which one I would choose.
I'm going to assume it's the miniature bat phone.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
I know.
All right. I'm going to find one. I'm going to find the little toy of that and paint it red and send it to you.
Awesome. That would be great.
And then tell you that I bought it on, you know, an auction site, and it's the actual one.
It's the authentic phone.
Yeah. It now, should have been a princess phone.
Yes, that's what they
that would be Batgirl's. You know, if they had a fourth season, then Batgirl would have had a princess phone, you know, a miniature Princess Batgirl phone, you know.
Right. All right, so the trivia question is so easy from Joel Eisner's Bat Book. Who are the six villains that Cassandra sprung?
As you say, the core four. Mm-hmm. I love that. The core four. So Joker, Riddler, Penguin, Catwoman. Right?
Right.
And then Egghead and King Tut.
Yep. There you go.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
I think it's kind of, you know, actually, if they were going to do this, like you said, and we didn't get the full blown out multi-episode type thing as Batman rounds them up and stuff, I don't understand then why not, or maybe it was budget, maybe they didn't want to pay even more extras, but like really go all out for that quick scene and maybe have, you know, Louis and maybe not Bookworm because getting into that leather costume would have been, but, you know, some of the others. Just in the back, especially since we saw none of them. Like, really, almost like in a way where it could have been the opening of the Batman show with the cartoon where they're all coming towards them, the two of them.
Yeah.
You know, you could have done something similar. You could have done an homage right there.
If you're going to do this idea at all, do it at the beginning of the half hour.
Mm.
You know? Yeah. Have this be Cassandra's main thing. And, boy, you know, this just opens up. It's like, why is she doing this in the first place? Why share the city with these criminals?
Mm.
And these criminals who are, you know, are going to turn on you, you know? It seems more trouble than it's worth.
Yeah.
And of course it didn't do her any good, for that matter.
Well, she clearly demonstrates she doesn't know them very well because...
Yeah.
You know, well, with what she's offering them...
She has a big L on her forehead anyways, you know. We know that from her family history.
Yes.
So it could only have ended up this way.
Okay, so let me ask you this. You're Robin the Boy Wonder. Mm. You've watched this episode as lifelessly as Robin himself was acting in this. You turn to Batman with a listless head, and you exclaim, "Holy what?"
totally let's just get this thing over with, Batman.
Wow.
I know.
And yet, you know something? We've spoken for over an hour about this episode.
I know. Well, it's what we always say. We go back to it time and time again. Even the worst episodes of Batman have things in them that are worthy of talking about. And, you know, it's a shame in some ways because you want it to be more. But then, like I said, it also spurs on, you know, conversation. So, you know, even the worst episode, I'm sure that when I don't know who's doing Minerva, but I'm sure you're going to get a whole, you know, hour out of that one.
Oh, well, sure. I mean, well, that's the final episode. Yeah, Robert Long's going to be in on that one. So.
Fantastic.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So, Jim, I forgot to give my rating here. I guess I got so wrapped up in it. I would say holy disappearing act.
and then there were none.
I mean, there are some things I liked about this episode, and there are a lot of things I didn't like. You know, sometimes I ask the question, would you revisit this episode? I would, just because of certain elements, like the idea that the villains have escaped and Batgirl being in the Batcave. But yeah, this really, you know, sadly, as the penultimate episode, it's a letdown.
Oh my gosh, we didn't even talk about that. Batgirl in the Batcave.
Yeah.
That's my whole thing, right?
Yeah.
We glossed right over that one. yeah, well, you know what? Again, that's not given any time, you know.
No. No, it's not.
What is this? She says to Robin, and he says, it's functional.
It's functional, yeah.
Like, oh, you smart aleck kid.
But that's the thing. It's like, because the episode is so lackluster, you don't get excited by the idea that Batgirl's in the Batcave. Really. You don't think about it. It doesn't have the same oomph like some of the others have.
Yeah. Yeah, when Gordon visits the Batcave the first time, not when he's under... Who is it? It's Minerva, right? Minerva's influence? Or is it... Sirens. Okay. When he goes the first time, when Batman actually takes him, they actually stop the story, and it's just for about a minute, you know, and deal with the idea of Gordon in the Batcave.
Yeah.
He's amazed, and he Batman actually allows him to kind of look around a little bit, and he says a few things about, you know, about what, you know, what we had to go through to put it together and all of that. You know, obviously they had the time, two-part episode, you know, but that's what it needs. Anytime somebody is in the Batcave that doesn't belong there, you know, you need to give them the chance to you know, awe and wonder, you know, with it. And especially Batgirl.
Right.
You know, there's so much that needs to be said, you know, about it. Is she jealous at all? You know, would she like to someday have something like that for herself? Blah, 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 and on and on and on. So, yeah, just too quickly taken care of it, especially for me because, you know, I love those moments.
Yeah, yeah. Well, especially like because, you know, the way we seem to get the overall impression of Batgirl in the comics is that she's always admired Batman. And, you know, we don't get anything here in the sense of, my gosh, you know, the reason I became Batgirl or what, I don't know. It would have been, again, because it's so lackluster, the moment is just passed. And that's why we managed to miss it in our discussion.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Yeah. That's kind of a tribute to how it was done right there, is that we forgot to even go into it. I mean, I forgot to go into it. You know how I love those scenes.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So, Jim, as we come to the end of the episode, you know, what's going on with you, your writing and such? What can we look forward to in the coming months ahead from Jim Beard?
Hopefully my Spider-Man novel will be out in the fall. What else am I working on right now? I'm just about ready to start writing my Kolchak novel. We had a little exchange about that on Facebook.
Yes.
So you're a Kolchak fan, I assume.
Oh, big Kolchak fan. My gosh.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I'm really excited about that. That's going to be my next thing that I'm starting in on. And in September 27th, I think it is an official X-Files anthology comes out with my story in it, desperately seeking Mothman. And I'm really excited about that. And this is fun because now I'm going backwards. I'm going to Kolchak, which is one of the big inspirations, you know, for X-Files. Right. So I'm kind of completing something here in my mind. And then in January, I have an official Planet of the Apes prose anthology that I both co-edited and contributed to. So I'm really excited about that.
Very nice. Very nice. So we'll put up links for the Planet of the Apes anthology and the Spider-Man novel when, you know, they're being released. It's going to be through Amazon?
Yes. Yeah. So, all of that. Yeah. Right now, there's the X-Files book is up on Amazon. It's called X-Files Secret Agendas. And there's actually a listing for the Planet of the Apes book, although the final real title is not up there and no cover image. Those are still coming, but that is up there. And I think you go under Classic Planet of the Apes, a prose anthology, if I'm not mistaken, to find that one. You can pre-order that one, too. And it has a January date for it. Spider-Man's not up yet. I hope that will not be too long. And Kolchak, again, like, I'm just starting to write that, so I'm hoping that could be very early next year.
Well, Jim, you know, as always, thank you again for being here, and, you know, thanks for taking some bullets from time to time with episodes like this.
my pleasure. And it's just dawning on me right now. This is my last episode, right?
Yeah.
I mean, pardon me, of the episodes of the show. Hopefully I get to come back and do some of the back computer ones. Love to talk about that imaginary fourth season. You know, the more I think about it, the more fun of an idea that is.
Oh, yeah, no, we're definitely going to do that because that should be a lot of fun.
Yeah.
So, folks, stay tuned. This is it, the final episode. The long, strange trip is coming to an end as I am joined by Robert Long to talk about, is it Minerva Mayhem and Millionaires, or is it, I forget which way it goes. I think it's Minerva Mayhem and Millionaires.
I think that's a statement in itself right there. You can't even remember the title of that damn thing.
Right. So until next time, citizens, take care. And Jim, once again, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening, chums. I don't have a bat phone, but you can contact the Batcave Podcast through its Facebook page, Twitter, email at thebatcavepodcast@gmail.com, or by phone at 888-866-9010. Subscribe to the podcast via libsyn.com, that's libsyn.com, or through iTunes. The Batcave Podcast is part of a series of pop culture podcasts from the Chronic Rift Network. Find them at chronicrift.com. So until next time, citizens, same bat time, same Batcave Podcast.
Commissioner, you don't suppose Dr. Cassandra and Cabala could pop their way out of Gotham State Prison?
Not the way Warden Crichton pops them in, Chief O'Hara.
But if she manages to smuggle one of her camouflage pills...
The prison matron isn't named Mrs. Frisk for nothing, Chief O'Hara. Besides, the warden had special polka dot cells painted for them. They won't blend into that background. Say, my, this is certainly a fancy spa.
What did I tell you, Commissioner? Will you try one of Minerva's eggplant jelly vitamin scalp massages?
Eggplant jelly? Mm-hmm.
That's right, boys. Just register. Check your valuables. And after treatment in my mirror spa, you'll feel like a new man. I certainly feel like a new man.
Commissioner Gordon and Chief O'Hara will indeed feel like new men after a treatment in Minerva's mineral spa. For Minerva's treatment has many surprises. One, a startling device for relieving Gotham City's millionaires of all their millions, as you will see in our next episode.